During the First World War, Germany had no choice but to sign a treaty that would end the war. This treaty was known as the Treaty of Versailles. It stated that Germany was not only responsible for the war, but it also had to pay all war reparations. Their land was split up among neighboring countries, including the German area of Alsace and Lorraine. The German army also was dissolved and the country was demilitarized.
However, in 1933, with the votes of the people, Adolf Hitler became Chancellor of Germany. Hitler immediately began building up the Nazi army. And in 1936, Hitler signed two treaties that allied Germany with Italy and Japan. Hitler's next step was to take back the land that was taken from them after World War I. Hitler's troops invaded and took over Austria and Czechoslovakia. Britain and France were outraged and promised to take action against Hitler's Nazi army if they invaded Poland. However, German troops invaded Poland on September 1, 1939, igniting the Second World War. On September 3rd, Great Britain and France declared war on Germany, Italy, and Japan.
The United States intended to stay out of World War II. The US watched as Hitler's Nazi army crushed six countries in 3 months, including Denmark, the Netherlands, Norway, Belgium, Luxembourg, and France. On December 7, 1941, Pearl Harbor Naval Base in Hawaii was attacked by the Japanese. The Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor for 2 hours, leaving more than 2,400 Americans dead. The following day, President Roosevelt declared war on Japan. But why did Japan join the war? And why did they choose to fight alongside Hitler's Nazi Germany? Well, we have to start with the birth of Japanese Emperor Hirohito.
Hirohito was born in Japan on April 29th, 1901. He was the son of Emperor Taisho and would become the next Emperor of Japan after his father's death. In 1926, soon after Emperor Taisho's death, Hirohito became Emperor. The Great Depression in Japan caused an economic collapse in which prices and unemployment skyrocketed. The civilian government lost power and the military established almost complete control over the government. The Japanese military also influenced many of Hirohito's decisions. In 1931, the Japanese army invaded the Chinese region of Manchuria. Japanese troops conquered the entire region, establishing the independent state of Manchukuo, governed by Japan.
In 1937, Hirohito reluctantly gave the military permission to invade China. Japanese troops quickly advanced and took over most of the Chinese coast, including the cities of Shanghai and Nanking. The Japanese committed severe war atrocities on Chinese civilians. During the rape of Nanking, over 300,000 civilians were killed. The Allies, including Britain and the United States, sent an ultimatum to Japan asking to remove troops from China and Vietnam. Japan rejected the ultimatum, and the Allies announced an oil embargo on Japan. Japan relied on the US for 80% of its oil, and they had to make a decision. The Imperial Japanese Navy prepared to attack Pearl Harbor, the Philippines, Netherlands, East Indies, and the British colonies.
The Japanese, in my opinion, will never crack. They will never surrender. They have got to be beaten until they know they are beaten. They believe they are going to win this war, and they are ready to keep on fighting for 100 years, if necessary.
Fighting a war against Japan presented the Allies with completely new problems. The Japanese army fought with unknown tactics and different strategies. Although Japan was small, they had already shown the Allies that they were qualified to fight in a full-scale war. After the Second Sino-Japanese War, in which Japan invaded China, the Allies knew what Japan was capable of doing. At the start of World War II, Japan captured approximately 350,000 prisoners of war. Many of these prisoners were native soldiers living in western colonies near Japan, and were released as long as they didn't resist the Japanese. However, about 140,000 Allied soldiers were kept imprisoned in Japanese camps. British, Australian, Filipino, Canadian, Russian, Chinese, and American prisoners were kept in Japanese prison camps, where the soldiers were starved, worked, and punished to death. The Japanese people didn't believe in surrender. To them, surrender meant giving up on yourself and your country. Therefore, the Japanese were known for their brutality and cruelty toward the Allied POWs. As a result, one in every three prisoners died in these camps, and the surviving prisoners would be worked and punished to their breaking point.
The Allied prisoners of war, or POWs, were placed in a number of camps. There were seven main camps under Japanese control, and under each main camp there were three other kinds of camps: branch, detached, and dispatched camps. These separate camps were used to isolate prisoners. After captured, the Allied POWs were brought to one of these seven camps on what were known as hell ships. Hell ships were boats that transported POWs but looked like Japanese merchant vessels. Because of the boat's appearance, Allied air and submarine forces often attacked the hell ships, killing about 11,000 Allied prisoners by the end of the war.
When the POWs arrived at the camps, they were situated in barracks, often an 8x15-foot room that held about 40 prisoners. The prisoners slept on wooden bunks, often without enough blankets to stay warm during the winter months. The Japanese gave the POWs starvation rations of about 600 calories a day. The usual meal was a bowl of rice, a cup of miso soup, and some pickles. These small food rations kept the prisoners alive, but it was extremely hard for them to carry out their daily forced labor. Starvation and malnutrition caused one in three prisoners to die, and by the end of the war, all the POWs were physically weak and underweight. The POWs were forced to work in mines and construction, often working 10 to 12 hours a day.
Japanese were experts in torture, and because they didn't believe in surrender, their methods of torture inflicted extreme pain and killed innocent prisoners. Japan ignored the terms of the 1927 Geneva Convention, and the Red Cross was forbidden to visit the camps. Disease spread like wildfire, and prisoners were beaten and executed every day. When POWs fell ill, medical attention rarely followed. If POWs attempted to escape the camp, they would be executed with a sword in front of the other prisoners.
In April 1942, after the Battle of Bataan in the Philippines, 75,000 American and Filipino prisoners were ill and starving. On April 9th, 1942, General Edward King surrendered to the Japanese. From there, the Allied prisoners were marched from the Bataan Peninsula to the Japanese prison camps. These men marched 90 miles, and an estimated 10,000 Filipinos died of dehydration, sickness, and executions. Elias Coloma, a Filipino death march survivor, recalls prisoners being tied to trees and killed if they tried to drink muddy water or eat wild rice. The prisoners were beat and had to bury their companions, or they'd be beheaded with a sword. He arrived at Camp O'Donnell in about 5 days. The camp conditions were so horrible that malaria and starvation claimed another 22,000 Filipino lives. Elias's weight had dropped from 130 pounds to 70 pounds. He was later rescued towards the end of the war.
What was it like along the march? People would like to hear what the conditions were like and how people were treated.
Well, there was an elderly marcher, prisoner. He could hardly walk. And he has to move to escape the bayonet shot.
So if you fell or dropped behind, they would kill you?
Oh, yes.
So you had to keep going.
That's why approximately 15 to 20,000 missing on the way. I think you can say 2,000, maybe more, escape. But you can estimate that that number of people and the distance you can see somebody dying every 12 or 15 feet apart.
How many people in total were on the march?
70,000 was caught. There were 10,000 or 12,000 wounded in hospital one and hospital two. You know, just imagine they just put them right in the open. There is no cover. Right in the open. And if you cannot walk, it's a bad luck. You cannot walk. You cannot move. And they went to the hospital just to kill.
Really? So they killed everybody
they
in the hospital?
They cannot walk.
If they couldn't walk, they were killed.
The Burma-Thailand Railroad, also known as the Death Railroad, was a slave labor project that killed 16,000 prisoners of war and 90,000 Asian slave workers. Many of the prisoners working on the railroad were captured in Singapore earlier in the year. These prisoners were mostly British, Australian, and Dutch. The POWs and Asian slave workers were forced to build a 260-mile-long railroad by hand that would connect Burma to Thailand. The railway was built in just over 12 months. After liberated, the Allies found out that 6,500 British, 2,800 Dutch, and 2,700 Australians had died during the construction. The most famous portion of the railway was Bridge 277, also known as the bridge over the River Kwai. This bridge was later bombed by the Allies in 1945. The bridge is located in the town of Canterbury, and a war cemetery was later established to honor the Allied victims of the Death Railway. Another difficult stretch of the railway was known as Hellfire Pass. The prisoners had to blast through rock without proper construction tools. The conditions were horrendous, and many POWs lived to tell the tale.
February the 15th, 1942. Singapore has fallen into the hands of the Japanese. The last bastion of the British Empire is lost. With this latest victory, Japan is to become the new master of Asia. The Imperial Army boasts its victory with a parade in front of 85,000 British and Australian prisoners. Most of these men will be forced to build a railway line 2,000 kilometers further north, deep in the Thai jungle. Working alongside a huge group of 250,000 Asian laborers, they will begin to live an incredible secret story.
It was probably one of the worst experiences, the march, because by then our boots had given out and we were down to bare feet. And your feet are European, our feet are tender enough anyway, and to become sort of used to walking on these rough tracks and splinters in our feet was very uncomfortable. But after a time, with all the other miseries, the hunger and the fatigue and the sheer exhaustion of it all, and the fact that you were being goaded on by sticks and shouts and threats, marching from area to area, you tended to forget your feet, you know. But we arrived at certain stages, Wampo, for instance. I suppose we walked in terms of miles, say, shall we say 20 miles at a time. And there we would find the Japanese had come up by river by barge, which they used barges frequently on, which we now call the River Kwai. And they'd form the basis of a camp there. And we'd have to build a camp and bury the dead who died and so on and so forth. And then when that section of the railway was complete, we'd move. We'd been marched onto another section. This is how it progressed, you see. I've described in Tamajo 241 how we were at Tarso for some time, and the first of the many dead began to appear, and sadly, we had to bury them there, you know. We buried most of the men that died until cholera struck later on. I'm running ahead of myself. When cholera struck, was no longer a question of burial, it was a question of incineration. We had to burn their bodies, you know, like sticks, throw them on like matchsticks.
With the surrender of Singapore in 1942, thousands of Allied troops became prisoners of the Japanese. From this huge force, a contingent of Australian and British POWs was sent to work at Sandakan Camp in North Borneo. The fate of these prisoners was to prove one of the grimmest of the war. While 150 officers were moved away to another camp, of the 2,400 prisoners remaining at Sandakan, only six men would survive to the end of the war. With his wife Evelyn, Owen visits the site of Sandakan Prisoner of War Camp, today a peaceful memorial park, where it is hard to imagine the horrors suffered here.
See, that's where your camp was, in there, behind there. It's all grown up now, see? You can just imagine what it was like. No roadways. The only road came out through down there, went down that way.
Sandakan Camp was 8 miles inland from the coastal town of Sandakan itself. Here, the Japanese brought two groups of prisoners, a total of 2,000 Australians and 500 British, to build an airstrip for the Japanese.
They saw him handed to him with that poor bloke, the most like taking away and shoot him. They had one intention, they wanted to kill us.
Jim Milner was one of 150 Australian officers who spent nearly 18 months at Sandakan before being suddenly moved to another camp.
Well, then the Japanese decided they had to meet their timetable. So they brought in a team of bashers.
If you got up to wipe your brow, you got a whack.
And we all had to stand with our arms out and the sun without hats until people were dropping.
So I got stood up and got my pair of wings, as we used to call it, with your arms outstretched and look at the sun for an hour and a half.
And stand there as long as they wanted you, looking at the sun.
The cruelest torture inflicted on the prisoners was confinement for long periods without adequate food or water in the punishment cage, a cramped wooden box on stilts.
You couldn't stand up, it was only about 4 foot high. And after the third day, they give us our first drink of water. And they made us drink that much, and we were sick. And then on the seventh day, the seventh evening, they give us a meal, our first meal. And then it was half rations from then on. We'd all run around behind the guardhouse and fight the dogs for their dogs, their scraps. And we'd be fighting a dog over a bone. A cranky, savage dog, we'd be pulling the bone out of his mouth and he'd be trying to snatch it back.
March had begun.
Men started to drop out straight away.
A lot of them were suffering the after effects of malaria. You can just imagine how they were. I think nearly everybody had touch of beriberi.
We ran out of food. All we was eating was little shoots of the fern shoots and bamboo shoots. Any little snails or anything that we seen, we put in.
Overnight, they used to ask you to bring all the sick men out and put them there. You get down the track a little bit and you'd hear the machine guns going off. I don't think anybody that wasn't there would never actually believe half of it if you told them, they wouldn't believe you.
What went on there? How the hell that the men went through? No one will know. You couldn't tell them.
Just close your eyes, remember them when you last saw them going away.